Good morning. It's time and we have a quorum. Let's get started. Item 1 on the agenda. Since the last meeting, members have received multiple information papers. The details are listed on the agenda. Do members have any comments on the information papers? If not, let's enter the next item on the agenda. Items for discussion at the next meeting. The next meeting will be held on the 26th of April, which is a Tuesday, at 2:30 p.m. The administration proposes to discuss the following three issues. The first, the West Kowloon Reclamation, and the West Kowloon Reclamation main works footbridge at junction of Strathmore Road and Tonkin Street West in Central Po, and two, improvement works at Tile Phase 2 Stage 1, and three, establishment of the Land Tile Development Office and the reorganization of existing development offices of Civil Engineering and Development Bureau. And on the 8th of March, the Secretariat issued PWP item number 196WC, implementation of Water Intelligent Network. And this is paper CB brackets 1660/15 and 16/01. Some members feel that before the funding proposal is submitted to the PWSC, it should be discussed at a panel meeting. Barring objections from members, I suggest to discuss the relevant items at the 26th of April meeting. And for item 3 of the agenda, the establishment of the Land Tile Development Office and reorganization of existing DOs, we actually discussed this issue at the last meeting. So I have to examine the papers to see if there are any changes. We have covered that last time, so barring any changes, I will suggest that we deal with items of higher priority. Mr. Leng Qicheng raised the issue of potential dangers of land management or refuse, so I will look at the details before I finalize or decide whether to deal with item 3 next time. And other members might wish to discuss certain items. We have 4 items already at the next meeting. So time-wise, I hope that members would agree that the meeting be extended by 2 hours to 6:30 p.m. And I will consider convening special meetings as well. So do members have any comments on such arrangements? Mr. Wuchi, why? And the government intends to discuss the establishment of the Land Tile Development Office again. So what are their grounds? This is merely a suggestion. So I would see whether there's a need to discuss the item again. It has been discussed recently, so I feel we might not need to discuss it again that soon. So perhaps we can consult Mr. Hon Qicheng, the Permanent Secretary, to see what the arrangements would be. The impression is that nothing much has changed. So perhaps we should discuss other items of interest. Yes, I understand. I just want to confirm this point. At this stage, we haven't seen any changes. So I agree. I just wonder whether this topic would be dealt with in the current term. We have a lot of items to deal with at the panel of development. So perhaps I would invite Mr. Hon, the Permanent Secretary, well, at the next meeting, we have three items on the agenda. We talked about the establishment of the Lantau Development Office and the redevelopment of existing DOs. We have covered the topic last time. And some members are concerned whether there are significant changes. Chairman, we are preparing the papers. The administration hopes to come back to the panel as soon as possible and take in views from members on the establishment of the Lantau Development Office by the CEDD. The administration feels that there's an urgency to set up this office, as I said at the panel meeting last time. We want to implement the Lantau blueprint shortly, so there's an urgency for the Lantau Development Office. We are preparing the papers already. So if we have no amendments to this item, I would not include this item for discussion at the next meeting. We have a lot of projects to deal with at the panel, and as I said, we might have to convene special meetings. Outside of this item, we have three other items to discuss. So we might assign higher priority to what Mr. Leung Chee Cheung mentioned. At some suspected illegal dumping at Tin Shui Wai and Lao Fao Shan. And we might be looking at potential land mismanagement at these areas. So I think these items would be of a higher priority for your item. It's important as well, but barring any changes or amendments, members have expressed their disapproval last time. So unless you have made changes, there's little point of discussing it again. I understand the workload of the panel is heavy, and at the last meeting we took in different views, and as we said, we are already preparing the papers, and we will see whether any amendments could be done. So hopefully we can be given some time, and later we would report our progress.
Since I have not read the document, I don't really know, but some members may have the same concern as I do, so I have to review it and to see if the item 3 can be included in the next meeting, whether we should have 4 items for the next meeting, and if there is any idea on that, any decision on that, I will inform you accordingly. Mr. Alan Leung, just one sentence. I have written one letter to you. The Civic Party is concerned with the 5 plots of land for hotels in the original Kai Tak Airport and at the coastal areas. There are 5 plots for development of 5 hotels. These are private development on public recreational land. So we would like to know the details. Why is it so? Because we have concerns. And the secretary says that it is too soon to arrange that. Chairman, perhaps Mr. Leung was not here a little beforehand. These are also concerns, and we have all looked into the matter. So do we need to have added meetings? That's a matter to be decided. These concerns that you have raised, I've also asked the Secretariat to invite the government to respond to these concerns, preliminary concerns, preliminary responses. So perhaps we have too many, maybe should we have too many items of agenda, we will add perhaps a meeting. For matters of concern and worth discussing, I will do my best to arrange for discussion time. If you don't have any more other concerns, we will turn into item 3, Project Cost Management Office. I would like to invite the delegate from representative from government on this item to make a presentation. I would say a few words. Good morning. We are present to you the works branch of the Development Bureau has made a suggestion for a establishment of Project Cost Management Office. And when it is gone through by you, we will go to the ESC. And the policy address and the finance report that construction costs are on the rise, we should control the costs. And the Secretary for Finance feels that we have interdepartmental cost management office valid for 3 years to control the costs. We have three approaches. We will, for the design, for the budget, for the purchasing, we should have more work on that so that we can control the costs. Mr. Kong Ka-sing, I will invite him to make a PowerPoint presentation. Mr. Kwong, the government for the capital works, as far as it's concerned, we are carrying them out to maintain the competitiveness of Hong Kong. And we have also kept a close eye on the cost of construction. We can see that the tender prices are on the rise. And in the last 3 years, the increase has been 22% for the government works. Similar to that of the private center. And also, there is a 14% of the rise of the material rise. Now, this, the recent, was due to global construction material price, local overall construction volume, and economic condition. The additional cost increases are due mainly to the increase in manpower materials input and as well as higher tender premium. And because of the requirements for the environment, so the works need a lot more input from of human and material resources. As recently, there are also fluctuations in the prices. That is to say, that is additional tender premium. In the policy address this year, it is pointed out that there is a need for government to strengthen cost control. And in the budget presented by the Secretary of Finance, there is also a requirement to strengthen cost control of public works. We will have a new dedicated office that is established for multidisciplinary approach to devise, promote, coordinate cost reduction initiatives and project cost control. And this office will regularly report to the Financial Secretary. In order to effectively control the costs, we have three-pronged approaches to strengthen the cost control. We will have strengthened the project and project scrutiny. We will also have a policy review of the works, and we'll also enhance project management. As for the new policy, we will have established a cost benchmarking system, and the government housing should cost should be below the benchmarks, and we also we will also enhance the design, standardization, mechanization, and construction by prefabrication. We also adapt the guiding principle of design for construction to ensure designs are practical. And we also enhance procurement method as well as the tendering so as to reduce the costs of the works. We also strengthen the project-by-project scrutiny, including a close scrutinization of over 300 projects in planning and design stage. We also strengthen vet and review of preliminary cost estimation, and we will also provide technical support for project cost control to client bureau. And in the enhancing of project management, we will enhance cost estimation and project management, and will also strengthen project management system and training. As for the head of the multidisciplinary office, he will directly report to the permanent secretary for development. We will have a supplementary post for about 3 years to have a synergy of the various counterparts, and will also carry out coordination. It has 15 members of the team, including architect, engineer, quantity surveyor, technical grade, and general grade. We only increased 8 posts. We also have a restructuring over we will also regrade the 2 D1 posts. The post of CAS, one will regraded from CGE to CE, and the CAS W5 from CE to CGE. It is cost neutral. Now the question time. There are 5 members asking for the floor. Chen Kamnam, Mr. Chen Kamnam, Chen Yunhan. I would suggest 4 minutes. Questions and answers included. Mr. Chen Kamnam, recent years, all the works projects have serious overruns. There are a lot of reasons resulting in the overruns. That would include the cost management as well. So perhaps strengthening cost management can help us to control the costs. Now, there are some issues of in the designs. We should have a no-frill approach. Very often, the works go for aesthetic effects, and that it means that it is more complicated and costs increase in costs. Now, the chief executive also mentioned that once the index or the target is the benchmark is decided, upon, then the tendering cost should be below that. How can we manage that? Very often, in the tendering process, the developers or the contractors work according to the benchmarks, and how can we then control the costs? The permanent secretary. As for the target price or the index price, we hope that we can then have a guiding principle for the private market. Of course, we need further refinement. However, our preliminary approaches for government buildings, for instance, schools or offices or the residences of for public servants. Now, we will look at the tender prices that we have received, and we will look at whether the designs are approved, and then we will look at the design so that the budget will not go beyond the ceiling, the cap of the benchmarks. However, we will go to the fundamentals, that is to say, we look at the design, and the budget will be controlled within the design. Do you mean that we do the design and then we go for tendering? If that is so, we will not have the package of design and build. So are you giving up the approach of design and build? No. Design plus build approach will not be done away with. However, even for design plus build, we have a reference design. Very often, so there should be requirements from the client, because the requirements of the client will affect the design. So the design plus build can still be used to control prices.
Next, Mr. Lo Wai Kwok. Thank you. First of all, on the establishment of a project cost management office and the relevant manpower, I am strongly supportive of the proposal. While the amounts of public works in Hong Kong at the moment is not a historical high, it amounts to $70 billion per year at current prices. I find this level reasonable. In the past two or three decades, look at the amount of public works, the peak was actually reached when we built the airport. Of course, prices have changed. Now we're looking at around $90 billion. And at that time, well, back then, the cost control was done more properly. So right now the amount of public works is not at a peak, and recently we have seen issues with cost management, and as such they warrant cost control measures. Now under the scope of responsibility, you said the office would review the pricing mechanism and or the control of tender prices and so on. Would you actually try to tackle the increase in construction costs? Now, a lot of industries are facing manpower shortage. Now, when we look at the population projection, our manpower would reach its peak by 2018, and different industries have to face manpower shortage. So would that be included in your studies? Now, project cost management is long-term work. It wouldn't be tackled within 2 or 3 years. Would this office be permanent? I believe project cost management is long-term work. Thank you very much for the question. First, in terms of manpower, we will see what we can do. As my colleague said, after the establishment of PCMO, a three-pronged approach would be adopted. First, reviewing public policy. Apart from benchmarking the construction costs, we would review the relevant public works policies. Now, we have actually done some studies. Very often, the increase in costs is based on certain redundant and long-standing requirements. And not all public works have to follow the same set of guidelines. For simple works, we don't necessarily have to follow very complicated guidelines. And of course, salaries have increased and we lack manpower. These are obvious. Now, please allow me to complete. Please try to be brief. We would promote automation and standardization in order to minimize manpower requirements. Now, recently, we have granted a site in Cheng Yi by short-term tenancy for metal works. We have a lot of issues to deal with, so there's nothing we can do. Mr. Albert Chen. I'm surprised why the proposal for a project cost management office is proposed at this time. The peak for public works has actually passed. A lot of mega works have been approved for the Lintang Boundary Control Point. They are yet to be commenced. But the biggest mega projects in history have been approved. And the worst time in terms of project costs have passed. And in the past 6 months, the tender prices have actually started going down. So what you're doing is anti-climatic, and you are doing it at the wrong time. If you did it 3 years ago, it would be commended. But right now, it's too late. The tender price is already going down, and now you are saying that you are going to establish the PCMO. So there's no way you can fail. So 3 years later, you would say your work is successful because the tender prices have gone down. But the fact is, the prices have started to gone down 6 months ago. And some construction workers are even worried that they would be out of a job. So I don't agree with this office. Why didn't the government do it 3 or 4 years ago? Right now, the tender prices are going down, and now you're trying to set up this office. Can you explain that, please? Mr. Hon, thank you very much for the question. In terms of works volume, the Construction Industry Council issued a forecast, and it was uploaded online. In the next 5 years, you can see the volume of works is going to rise. And they included both private and public works. A lot of private works are in the pipeline. In the current policy address, $200 billion would be invested into a private hospital, and there will be a railway review. And very shortly, we would see new projects. Within 10 years, in terms of housing, our target is 460,000 flats. And we have a lot of site formation works and other auxiliary works. So Mr. Chen said the tender prices are going down. We are actually monitoring the prices, but we have not seen any sharp drops. The growth is lower than previous years. You might say that the establishment of the office might come late, but you cannot say it's unnecessary. Can the government list out the expected expenditure in private works in the next 5 years? Now, I've told the administration to cap the costs at $180 to $200 billion. So the administration is obliged to monitor the prices. So I'm not very sure about the trends or figures given by the government. Now, can you share the relevant figures with us on mega projects? The third runway system would likely face delays due to objections, and with the developments at Northeast New Territories, there might be issues as well. So we are looking at a lot of controversial issues for the Kai Tak multipurpose sports ground. You will face a lot of objections as well. So you cannot assume that everything would go ahead. So please provide the figures after the meeting. Next, Ms. Chen Yun-han. Now, I have two questions, and I'd like to respond to what Mr. Edward Chen said. Please don't criticize the government for the sake of it. Of course, a lot of construction workers are out of a job. That's a fact. So please don't get political. Now, let's be reasonable. You should not skew the reality. I think you are better than that. Mr. Edward Chen, please don't speak. Please don't speak unless you are allowed to do so. Now, let's be logical. Now, I have a few questions for the government. Now, I'm not an expert in land planning. Now, I chat with the planning department all the time on the Kai Tak River Airport project, etc. Whenever we have major issues, well, for town village, the site involves the housing department and the planning department. So what do we do to tackle the issue? We involved 9 departments. So of course I would support this project. So are you trying to regurgitate old data? Now, in terms of project cost management, this is a big question mark. A year ago, with the XRL incident, it could not be. We knew that it could not be completed on time, and it created a shock and it created headlines all over Hong Kong. And we realized that the director of highways was part of the task force. So of course we would support this proposal, and we don't want to see further public works cost overruns. But a lot of political incidents recently are due to cost overruns. Now, if the director of highways is in the task force, and if he's only a yes man, so where's the monitoring? Where's the control? So I think you would agree with what I said. Now, if you want to control the cost of public works. If the government itself is not doing a good job, how can you get it done? Now, Mr. Hon has been in the position of Permanent Secretary for a long time. I've known him for a long time. So how can the government carry out its job? Now, I'm not saying that people should be fired, but some people should be held accountable. So what can you promise, Mr. Hon? Is there an accountability system? If there are issues, what will be done? Please be brief, Mr. Hon. Thank you very much for the question. The first question was why no one is doing any work. Of course, staff from different departments would be responsible for project cost management. At the works, at the Development Bureau, we have a team, but we do not have a dedicated unit on cost control. So this time we are trying to set up a cross-disciplinary team to tackle the work. The relevant departments would continue to work on cost control. But as I said, we want to start from the basics. We would adopt a three-pronged approach. We would tackle issues like design and procurement. Now, we're looking at more than 300 projects worth more than $300 billion. So we want to see if we can control the cost better. Now, Chairman, he didn't answer my question. What about the accountability system? Is there such a system in place? Of course, we are blameless. Now, we want to work on, we want to start with the basics. Well, I would wait for my second round. Mr. Yu Si-wing, please. Thank you, Chairman. Now, there have been major cost overruns in recent public works. I support the setting up of a new office under a three-pronged approach. In a lot of major public works, I see that the government would adopt a three-pronged approach and try to manage the costs. So I'd like to know the division of labor between this new office and the existing staff who are responsible. Would there be any redundancy in roles? Now, if certain offices or government staff are not behaving as they should, what would the PCMO do? Now, the task of this office is to manage project costs. Now, for specific projects, once funding is secured, the relevant departments would still be responsible for overseeing the work. Now, this is not a huge office. We only have a dozen people or so. It's impossible to dedicate staff to specific projects, so there would not be any redundancies with the departments. And the PCMO would work on the basics using a three-pronged approach. For existing regulations or contractual provisions, the office would see whether they are necessary and whether a better job can be done in terms of design. And we hope to come up with benchmark costs which serve as a reference point. And at the design stage, whether convenience for building has been considered. in a lot of the cases, it has not been taken into account, so the works would not turn out satisfactory at the site, and there would be a waste of resources and manpower. So we would focus on the basics. Now we have more than 300 public works which have not been tabled in LegCo. They would be dealt with batch by batch and see if anything can be optimized in order to reduce the costs.
Thirdly, we would like to have more training, especially in project management, to reinforce the awareness and knowledge of our colleagues. So that is the three-prong approach. Mr. Yao. So for the existing works, this PCMO will not deal with it, but deal with future works. Well, of course, we will focus on future work projects. However, if there are major changes in the existing projects, we will also look into that. If there is a design change, we will see if their costs can be reduced. So for existing works, that will be the responsibility of the departments concerned. Mr. Wu Qiwei, I would like to go to PowerPoint 7 and 8. In the strengthening of project and project scrutiny, you are asking the office to strengthen the scrutinization and review. What are the methods that will be adopted? There are questions raised on that. In the budgeting, very often you reference the projects before, similar projects before. So you go for the estimates of the reference projects. Do you have a new method? As far as we understand, the material scrutiny is a different thing. So in fact, you have to have data collection for the different materials for the different parts of the projects in order to reach an estimation. So do you have any new change in the estimation? Would that be the responsibility of the office? And you are for the 300 existing projects in apart from the review, are you going to have the standardization, the mechanization, and the prefabrication? Are you going to adopt this? So in fact, the office is performing a very important function. Lastly, we would also like to say that there is a problem of collusion or bid rigging, even for the public works, because there are 10 or 8 contractors that can bid for that. So how do you respond to the problem of this bid rigging because there are not enough competition among the bidders? Thank you for the three questions raised. The first one is the estimation. How can we really assure that the estimation will not be too far off from the bidding prices received? That is true. In the last few years, we did not really have a firm grasp of the market situation. We usually adopt the approach of risks for the estimation. Apart from referencing similar projects before, we will also estimate the risks involved. So we are now doing a study, and through this office, we can have further study to see whether we can have other methods of estimation. I cannot give you the details as of now, but we will study the matter. As for the 300 projects. They have not really come to the finance committee for funding. There are some projects in the pipelines. There are some projects on the design stage. So we are looking at these projects in batches to see if we can optimize the designs. And also, we will see if there are possible optimization of designs to reduce the costs. We will speed up such a process. And thirdly, whether we have enough bidders for the tenders. Now, our main aim is to encourage the lists in the roster, constructors in the roster, on the roster. There are rules and regulations, and we will also revise the rules and regulations to keep them up to date. Mr. Leung Chi-cheung, well, costs control is, of course, a good thing. For the PWP, if you have a saving of 1%, that is quite substantial. Now, I think the establishment of the PCMO is a recommendation that we could support. However, I have some concerns. For instance, you say that there may be regulations of designs that will be going back to the so-called standardization without any variety in PWP. They all look alike. So afterwards, there were some humanizations of designs. Now, for the PCMO, you are going back. Well, you may be saving some money, but the capital works of the government are looking all alike. And that is also a matter of concern. Now, the permanent secretary said that the PWPs, the rise or the fall of in prices of PWP are quite similar to that of the private sector. However, prices of the public works, in fact, are higher than the private sector. Well, of course, materials and staff costs are on the rise, but I think that the proportion of your price that can be higher than the private sector. Now it's about 3-4%. Can you reduce that gap? Mr. Hu Jiwei said that you are going for the constructors in the roster. You cannot go beyond the roster. Now, the list. Now, the constructors on the list may deliberately bid higher prices, but whereas for the private sector, they can go for any constructor. So could there be more constructors on the list so that we have more choices? Could that could the list be somehow revised? Now, as for the standardization of designs, no, we would not normalize the designs or regulate the designs. We will not, for the sake of prices, do away with creativity. Now, if there is possibility of optimization of designs, we'll do that. However, we also look back on the prices of similar projects as a means of indexing. We go for the no frills. Well, of course, aesthetic designs may not be the cheapest. Now, as for the difference in prices between the public and the private sector, the gap is not so large. In fact, the private sector prices rises have been higher than that for the public works. So it is not obvious that it is a rule that the prices for the private works would be higher than the public sector. So of course, we will also like to have more entries to the list for PWP. Mr. Kenneth Chen, I think we are confusing two things. As a member of LegCo, of course, we should keep the wallet of the public money. So we have no frills designs, we'll have a good tender price, and we can also have a cap for the costs. Of course, all these we support. Now, however, you are asking for a PCMO, new posts, or new working procedure. Well, that's another kettle of fish. Now, for cost control, do we really need and require a project cost management office? I don't think so. In the last 10 years, Chen Maobo, he said when in an interview, he said that we saved 30 billion in the last few years. Well, we could see overruns. For instance, the Taiwan Chai bypass, for instance, because the pre-investigations did not discover underground conditions. And perhaps the weather condition was not good. So sometimes you say that it's price rise, sometimes you said it's car force majeure. So you have all different reasons for the overruns. So you should refine the procedure within the departments instead of setting up an office. Well, you are throwing out money in a new office. I don't think that is the right way of going about. If you want to have a control, you should have a plan, and so give it to all the departments involved in the PWPs for them to implement. Well, unfortunately, you are not saying that there's something wrong with the procedures within the departments. Well, in the sociological studies, you are now being bureaucratic. Now, we need money, we squeeze your money to set up a new office, with the reason that you would like to have a cost control and you need an office. Well, the government has been saying that major overruns, you have given explanations that are extraneous as to the government. I think the crux of the matter is accountability. There is no accountability for the major projects that have overrun the costs. Up from the chief executive down to the officers in charge. There is no accountability system. So what about this office? Ultimately speaking, even with the office, there's still no accountability. So I cannot support this office. I support your cost control. You should internalize all the procedures. You should not have overlapping of the structure. It is putting the cart before the horse. In fact, you are wasting the public money, so I cannot support this office. For the cost management in the new projects, you should think more and you should optimize the flow of procedure and not setting up an office. So I oppose the setting up of the office.
Yeah.
Next, Mr. Chang Kim Paul. Thank you. I think anyone with some sort of vision would expect cost management from the government. Now, no one can guarantee that the number of works would not increase in the future. Now, you're assuming that the projects or works would be abandoned. Such claims are irresponsible. A multidisciplinary office would help lower the project costs, no matter the volume of works or the price levels. So I don't see any reason not to support this office. Now, people have been asking the government to control the costs, but yet they refuse to allow the government to set up an office. Right now, the work warrants a cross-disciplinary team. Now, if I spend $100, but in return I can save $10,000, why don't we do it? So anyone with business or management experience would not make such claims. So I'm fully supportive of this proposal. However, you still have to reach the Establishment Subcommittee and Finance Committee before it can be approved. With time running out in the current term, realistically, do you think it can be done? But this is very important. So what are you going to do? Are you going to redeploy resources internally and try to get it done first? Of course, I understand you face manpower shortage, but this is something which this is something really worth doing. Hopefully it can be done in the current term, if not the next term. Do you have a plan B? Or you are going to abandon it if you cannot secure the funding or if you face filibustering? Are you going to have a backup plan? Mr. Hon, thank you for your support. The work has already started despite the lack of hands. As I said, we have a management office, and some of our colleagues are doing the work on a part-time basis. But due to a lack of manpower, we cannot possibly do everything. Now, the establishment of this new office is well grounded, and we can tell people that this is of high priority. It's a long way to go before we submit this to the SENFC, but hopefully it can be done as soon as possible. What about the backup plan? So you would continue with your work despite the manpower shortage. There's very little other option. Anything to add? Well, we are already doing the work on a part-time basis. Dr. Elizabeth Quad, thank you. The public expects the government to make the best use of public money. Now, there have been project overruns in a lot of public works in recent years. Of course, the public would be angry. Now, the government is proposing a new office to try to lower the cost of public works, and of course we would support the proposal. For this new post, you said you would monitor the works. Would that include all public works, including infrastructure works? Would you only monitor public buildings? Now, we have a three-pronged approach. And one of the areas would be to vet the 300-odd projects. And they don't just cover housing and buildings. They cover all kinds of works. You said you would set a cost benchmarking system or indicators. Would you disclose these benchmarks or indicators? Would the public know the benchmarks? Yes, we would as much as we can. Now, we might issue technical guidelines which would normally be uploaded to our website. As Mr. Leung Chi-cheung said, you talked about standardized designs, but you said you would not restrict creativity. But I think the public is looking forward to more humanized designs. Would you try to do better on this front? Now, the main work of the PCMO is to manage costs. Now, we understand that human designs are very important, so the relevant departments would certainly give it a high priority, Chairman. Now, we are sometimes surprised by certain works for simple tasks, such as a rain shelter, a lamp, or a chair, and so on. They have to commission a consultant before outsourcing the work, and it's a long process and a lot of money has to be spent. So can such processes be streamlined to save time and money? Thank you very much for the comment. Now, as I said, one of the scopes of work would be to review existing works guidelines. If we see any redundancies, we'll certainly conduct detailed reviews. So some minor works might not require consultant work, and it can be taken up by your department. Is that what you mean? Now, I cannot answer very specific questions, but with the establishment of PCMO, we would deal with all public works, cost management, and processes. Are you going to review building standards? For instance, some roads might be full of trees, and it's impossible to install lampposts because of the guidelines. But in some very open areas, you said you have to follow the guidelines and install a lot of lampposts. So would you review such guidelines which seem unreasonable? Now, we have to look at the function. Now, the relevant departments might have to do reviews. Now, we will look at the big picture, but we might not be able to look at the fine details. Now, this is just an example of a waste of money, and it's an example of a very unfriendly design. Yes, I've he's heard the comment, Mr. Tenkapu. Now, recently, for the minor work in the outlying islands, which costs $100 million, both projects face cost overruns. And some members felt that there might be an error in cost estimation. On Lemma Island, a single story library and heritage gallery costs tens of millions of dollars. Now, it costs $50 or $60 million for a building with less than 2,000 feet of floor space. This is unreasonable. So I have some questions for the permanent secretary. You said you would vet 300 public works. Do they include transport systems under the THB? Now, most transport systems, transport systems are either under the Development Bureau or THB. Now, at the THB, they don't have a permanent secretary who can look after the work, so can you take care of those works as well? I read an article on Ming Pao. You said you would commission an independent building consultant to tackle quantity surveying and tendering. Now, for road systems, a consultant would be hired, but that would include, but that would double up as a contractor. I consulted experts in the field, and they said this is the case. So how detailed would you go? Would you look at roads and transport? Now, you mentioned 300 works. Now, suppose you have a vetting team or task force. Now, since you are unsure when you can secure the funding for this new office, the implementation dates for those 300 works might be delayed. Would that happen? Thank you. The PCMO will report to the financial secretary. So those 300 works are not just under the ambit of THB and Development Bureau. As I said, the government would invest $200 billion in private hospitals in the next decade. So we are not just looking at projects under the Development Bureau. Now, on the issue of the independent consultant, the case might be different for different projects. But for the PCMO, we would not rule out commissioning consultants for quantity surveying. Now, would that lead to delays in those 300 projects? Now, the progress of those 300 works would not be affected by the date of establishment of the office. Now, the current term, LegCo, is coming to a close. Now, would you able to table any works in the current term? Now, we are just working part-time before this new office is set up, so we can only do our best. And some public works can be tabled. Mr. Ray Chen, of course, cost management is a good thing. It's a basic responsibility. Now, the case is this. Someone is not doing a good job. They have made mistakes, and as such, you have to hire extra people to supervise these people. As Ms. Chen Yuhan said, we have to hold people accountable first. Now, for the Hong Kong Dry Macau project and XRL, the Highway Department has no responsibility in the cost overruns, and the solution is to hire more people to supervise their work, and we are not even sure whether it would work. And Chen Kim Po said no matter how big the cost overrun is, the work should be passed as soon as possible. So, and in terms of the timing of setting up this office, as Mr. Albert Chen said, this is a response to a policy address, and it's it should be done earlier. But some people said it should be, late is better than never. But we have missed the most crucial period. Now, I'm sure the government departments would do a better job, and the tender prices would go down within 3 years. Now, you want to create a supernumerary post. Now, no matter we approve the funding or not, the tender prices would go down because it's a natural cycle, and 3 years later, you are going to demolish this office. So how can you assess the performance of this office in the next 3 years to see whether it's a natural trend or due to your credits?
If three hours later the costs are still overrun, are you going to add staff onto the office? The Permanent Secretary, we hope to have a multidisciplinary team, and that is also been authorized by the Financial Secretary so that it will be dedicated to the cost management. And I think that this team will be able to function well because it will actively scrutinized the 300 projects that are already in the pipeline but have not yet seek funding from the Finance Committee. That will be about 300 billion. Well, if the team can play its role, the cost can be reduced. So I think that it is very useful to have a PCMO. And I cannot see whether there will be a reduction of the volume of the PWP when I respond to Mr. Albert Ho. Of course, I would also supply you with the required information. I feel that there will be still be a rise in the volume of PWP. Well, Mr. Chen, now, I think that you should give your experience to the different departments. I think that it is not because of the PCMO that costs will be reduced. Would you look into the matter where there is a misperformance of duties? And I think the answer, well, we have to look at the responsibility of the accountability of the different projects. This office is not a review team. It is for management. Mr. Chen Hangbin, of course that we have to go to the root of the matter for the overruns. For the bridge, MB, well, there are a lot of overruns. Because some original plans would need, for instance, 100 million, but because of filibustering, the prices rise as time is delayed. Now, we would like to know how many projects prices are impacted by the judicial reviews. So do you have an assessment of the risks involved in the possible judicial reviews with respect to the price rises? So how do you monitor or prevent the price rises and price the cost rises? There should be a team in charge of that. But however, I would like to know whether that will be an increase in the bureaucratic institutions, and would that be would that also have an effect on the approval time for the projects? Permanent Secretary, whether we have data at hand to know whether judicial reviews lead to cost rise. I think that all know that there are delays due to judicial reviews, and very often delays would lead to price rises. So I can furnish you with the information after the meeting. Secondly, we are not adding an institution. Now this is a structure with about a dozen staff, with several new posts created. Some posts are being filled by internal restructuring. Now, it is an independent team, so that will adopt a three-prong approach to control the costs. Mr. Chen, I hope that for some PWP, the approval has been a long, slow process, and costs are on the rise, because the funding approval and the judicial reviews would throw into chaos the original estimations. Well, Permanent Secretary, yes, funding approval has been rather slow. Before the funding, we will still go for tendering. And so we will also, through this process, obtain a more realistic estimation. Mr. Leung Ko-hong. Well, Mr. Hon, you are a public servant. You should tell us the truth. Well, judicial reviews, well, it is not an injunction that we are seeking to prevent you from working. For the HEZMB, the judge said, why is it that you are being so slow? The EIA is not being done properly. So when there is a judicial review, can these government still go ahead with the project? We are not asking for an injunction, but a judicial review. Don't raise to the lower denominator in the LegCo. Well, I think you should control yourself, not the cost control. Picky views should not be repeated by you. I think you are a public servant. You should have a spine. Has anyone prohibited any PWP? Well, you should make that clear. I think you should clarify this point. Are you asking for the Permanent Secretary to respond? It's not an injunction. Chen Hanben are mixing things. All are picky views. The HEZMB, if you follow the advice of the judge, you will have a better EIA. Would you allow him to respond? Permanent Secretary, for particular projects, I have no data. I'm asking about you for the judicial review and the injunction. There is data required. It is a very simple legal matter. Well, let me ask you. Mr. Long Hong Sui, he is the chief executive fan, and he has a lot of business deals with him, with the surveyor's business. And he has given a lot of money for the election. He is now complaining that I am a big company, but I don't have enough works, projects. Are you treating the government as an ATM of Mr. Vincent Low? Do you know how many projects he has had, Vincent Low, government projects? And he is surprised that he does not have enough projects. Do you have data on that? For the cost overruns, how much money is into his pocket? Mr. Chen Kimpo, has Mr. Vincent Low bought insurance from Mr. Chen Kimpo's insurance company? No. Well, you can do away with judicial review. Or you can say that all PWPs would not be judicially reviewed. Well, for a simple legal issue, you are playing around. So is there a difference between judicial review and injunction? Of course there is difference. The judge can look at whether there is administrative misconduct. For the links, when there was an injunction demand, it went up all the way up to the final court of appeal. The mic is not on. I think, Mr. Leung Kok Hong, your time is up. Mr. Leung Kok Hong, your time is up. Mr. Albert Ho, of course, the cost management should be done all the time. The crux of the matter is you are asking for an establishment office. What is the cost effectiveness? Now, I would like to ask whether the norms and standards of the office can be applied to all kinds of projects. Would you review each and every project during the tendering process? And would you do auditing in specific projects? Very often in the mega projects, they need to recruit consultants whether there are risks of the third runway, so as to know whether there are risks of cost overrun. For instance, they need a lot of laborers. Are there enough of them? Or the sea sand, they need special equipment. Do they have enough equipment? So in all mega projects, they all have their particular risk factors. Can you do this also, a risk assessment? So the Chairman Secretary, in fact, Paul Chen, he need only to do the review within the Bureau. So do you have an added value with respect to the risk factors? For the risk factors, we need to have more study and work done. When we are doing our estimation, we are risk-based. However, further work can be done. In fact, during the design stage, the risk studies should also be made. Perhaps we ourselves, we also do some black swan analysis and studies. This we will do, especially for mega projects. So when we are estimating risks, we would do more such work for mega projects. Whether we are going to intervene in each and every project, yes. For the three-pronged approach, for those projects in the pipeline, but not yet for funding, for all these projects, we will look into whether more work can be done for the design. And when once reviewed by us, they can go to the Finance Committee for funding. However, after that, it should return to the various bureaus and departments for cost management. Well, this office is not auditing, because the audit department will do the auditing. However, this office will not be auditing. They will look into the basics. I have emphasized several times that they will go to the basics, and whether there are some revision that can be made for the outdated approaches.
And we would also strive for design for construction in order to contain the costs. This is a small office, so hopefully we can manage the costs. We are talking about more than 300 projects worth more than $300 billion, so we can easily save some money. Now, I'm not saying that this is not worth doing. But you said you would look at the risk factors for each project. I just wonder whether you're capable of doing so. Now, usually consultants have to be commissioned before they compile reports on risk. Well, I'm not saying that we would assess the risk for each project. We are, I was merely introducing the latest approaches to risk assessment. And one of our areas of work is to enhance our colleagues' capabilities in project management. Next, Dr. KK Kwok. Now, we have seen ridiculous cost overruns for the Lintang boundary control point. The cost overrun is almost 50% for the Hong Kong-Macau Bridge. The overrun is more than 25% for the Express Rail Link. More than 19 billion has just been approved. So the eventual costs are very different from the original estimates. Now, from items A to F, I don't see any specific mentions to tackle these. Now, regardless of the tender prices, the government can come back for more and more money. For XLL, we are yet to deal with more than $20 billion in claims. So if you have to pay very little and you can gain a lot in return, of course I will say yes without any hesitation. But when I look at items A to F, you are not tackling the hierarchy or the structure. According to the paper, well, when you look at if you are to renovate your home, it's impossible to quote an initial price only to come back for 50% more. For Lintang BCP, the cost overrun is 50%, and Mr. Hon said the cost banky can be reduced by 1%. And for the contractor, it doesn't really matter for them. You know, even 49% is a lot of profit. Now the government is wasting money. As long as such practice is still in place, then the contractors would only try to fabricate the figures. For the Lintang BCP, XRL, and HZMB, for such for the major cost overruns for these projects, can you specifically tell us how you can erase these overruns through the work of this office? We are actually doing work already to streamline the contracts. In the UK, there's a new type of contract called NECs, or New Engineering Contracts. Recently, experts from the Institute of Engineers came to Hong Kong and we talked about this issue. The NEC system actually encourages risk management through contracts. A partnering approach is adopted. So hopefully the contract provisions can be improved. And for major works, we would establish target costs. And after a certain threshold, they have to shoulder the risks, and we will continue our work on this front. I mentioned other methods to better manage costs. We mentioned a three-pronged approach. We want to start from the basics in order to reduce costs. He didn't answer my question, Chairman. I read the items A to F. They are really irrelevant. I asked about the tender prices. You said you invited the Institute of Engineers to come for an academic exchange. there are hundreds of billions of worth of works, and still you are taking your time to discuss with the engineers when we are our money is going down the drain for NEC works. For mega projects, we see benefits in using this approach. So how would you define big projects? I think time is up. Next, Mr. Gary Chan. Thank you, Chairman. The setting up of the PCMO is a response to the policy address calls for a project management or project cost management mechanism. But I think the actual establishment of the benchmarks is important, but nothing has been mentioned in paper. So for a sports field, a public housing building, and so on, would you establish a maximum or cap for the construction costs? How would you come up with the cap levels? If a department wants to come up with a project which is more expensive than the benchmark, then would this office have the power to reject the proposal and request for refinements? The permanent secretary said this is a cross-disciplinary team instead of a interdepartmental team. Chairman, as you know, government departments seldom collaborate. So would the office actually have power or bargaining power? In the audit report or public accounts committee, some departments, for example, the civil aviation department, when they purchase equipment, they have to follow certain guidelines of the government logistics department, but at the end, these guidelines are not followed. You know, it simply becomes an exchange of papers, and no one's there to oversee the process. So if you have no actual power, people might not listen. So where's the effectiveness of the office? Now, let me answer the first question first. On the cross-disciplinary team, it would be set up under the Works Branch of Development Bureau, and it will report to me. Our team has to report directly to the Financial Secretary. So at different policy bureaus and departments, as I said, we would vet their works as well. But the power comes from the Financial Secretary. As for the cost benchmarking system, Mr. Chen can give more. Now, I will try to be concise. Now, for some PwSC papers, for example, building works, we stipulate the unit cost or square cost of the building. It might be government quarters, office buildings, and so on. Now, we try to work on the per meter unit cost, and we will look at the potential factors that affect prices, and we will see how much we can save. And with a benchmark established, the project architect can refine the design, and they can see if any money can be saved. And in some situations, there might be technical difficulties, so the benchmark might be exceeded, and that's permitted. So one of the jobs of the office is to establish the benchmarks or the benchmarking system. So if the benchmarks are exceeded, they can talk to the office to describe the specific circumstances of the office or the project. So would it be the PCMO or financial secretary say whether the benchmark is exceeded? We have not yet decided such detail. Next, Mr. Elvin Yeung. Thank you, Chairman. Now I have some questions. If Electrical refuses to the application for create this PCMO, does it mean that what you want to do cannot be done? Of course, you would say it will be difficult. But are you actually not doing such work at this moment? Mr. Albert Ho talked about a dedicated office. So what are they actually doing? That's my first question. And secondly, you mentioned the NEC. I think this is a good way to go, but can it not be done without the PCMO? And third, in terms of the scope of responsibility, in case of any project cost overruns, if contractors are allowed to make claims, do you have the power to refuse the claims? Now, if you only take up an advisory role, now this is different from if you actually have the real power. These are two different things. Now, first, if the office is not approved, can we do the work? Of course, I hope the office can be approved. Work has already started, and we are working toward this goal of having a new PCMO. The planning office of the Development Bureau only looks at capital works. They don't have to shoulder the work. But we expect this PCMO to be established, and we have a lot of work stacking up. But if this office cannot be set up at the end, we cannot carry out the work. Now, for the second question on the NEC, can we still go ahead with NECs without this office? Of course, the answer is we can still go ahead. We have already adopted NEC for some minor works. And the initial response is positive. Now, one of the jobs of the office is to review the procurement modes for major works worth over $1 billion, we would roll out pilot schemes. This is a new contract mode, so we cannot adopt a clear-cut approach. And with the PCMO, we can see whether adopting NECs for big projects would be beneficial to Hong Kong. If we are not able to roll out the pilot schemes, we would delegate the work back to the relevant departments. Now, in terms of the terms of reference, can we refuse claims from contractors? Well, I think the simple answer is for these contracts, there are provisions in place. The government or any contract party has to play by the contract. And we cannot bar the contractors from making claims. We have to play by the contract. Now, on this issue, I have a few questions as well. Now, project cost management is, of course, beneficial, and a lot of people would support it in order to manage costs.
For the PCMO office, well, it is a directorate post. We know that there are some electrical mechanical works. Since there are a lot of overruns in electrical mechanical engineering, do you really need more such people in the PCMO? There are the architect society as well as the surveyors association. They have all written to air their views. These are letters we have received in the last few days. Perhaps you can have a look at those letters and give them written responses. Their concerns would need explanations from the government. Thank you. For the recent views, we'll go and have a look at them. So the PCMO will be led by the engineers. Well, this is a multidisciplinary team. There will be architects, there will be surveyors, there will be also engineers. So this is a multidisciplinary team. Why is it that we feel that it should be led by an engineer? I think that we need to go to the basics. The basics would include the optimization of designs and also the difficulties encountered in the constructions and also the NEC approach, as well as the competition, increasing competition in the purchases, as well as risk control. So we all need a project manager. And we all know that engineer is most suited to the project management, as it is the bread and butter of an engineer. Chairman, I think that whatever leadership in the PCMO, the association are concerned whether he has all the necessary qualifications. The leader should not only be well-versed in one sort of a project. He need to cover a lot of other issues. Michael Tian would like to speak, and there are also other members that would like to speak for in the second round. We have been discussing this item for over an hour, and we still have three more items to go. They all need funding. After Mr. Michael Tian for the second round, he's the first round. In the second round, I will give you each 1 minute, and then after they have spoken, we'll ask the officers to respond collectively to the questions. Well, I thank you for allowing me to speak, even though I'm late. I support this proposal. As a developer for such a small company as ours, we need all this process. In the electrical, we have always criticized the government that how can you have funding before you allow tendering? Because when you have the funding already at hand, that all the tender companies would go to the maximum budget. So I think with this PCMO, I think everything will function better. That's why I support the establishment. Apart from the engineers, for ours, our business, we need an engineer. We need also lawyers. Cost overruns, constructors, the contractors, have also given you a lot of reasons for the overruns, the weather, the change of the designs, etc. If your contract is not well drawn up, then you will have all the other claims for the overruns. Now, so we should hold on to the legal responsibilities of the contractors and not the contrary. The contractors will also will always claim make claims against the government, and for such claims you have to go back to the electrical for overruns. Now, for the contract itself, we will take into account new engineering contracts from the UK. This is the direction that we'll take. We'll have a pilot testing. For one project, we will adopt the NEC to control the costs so that on both sides, the government and the contractor, we will have a better partnership relations to reduce the risk of claims. We have also consulted the societies and associations in the UK on that matter. On the cooperation, I have some doubts. When you are talking of money, you have different stands. Well, ultimately, you need to go to arbitration. So I think the contract should be well drawn to defend the interests of the government and the public money. Well, if cooperation can solve all the problems, there won't be what has happened for the XRL response. The contract aims for a partnership will help us to reduce claims. Of course, with matter to the technical matter of the claims, we need to have a well-drawn-up contract and we need to have a target cost. And according to the target cost, we will make arrangements. If we can save some money, it will be a win-win situation. However, it will if there will be losses, it will be borne by the contractor. There are 19 members who have spoken for the first round. And there is Albert Chen, Mr. Leung Kok Hong, that would like to have a second round. So I'll give you 1 minute each. And after questioning, the Permanent Secretary will answer all questions in one go to save time. Albert Chen, Mr. Albert Chen. Long hair was right. Well, we should not insult pigs. The slow beat also said that. If members distort facts, saying that any overruns are due to filibustering and judicial reviews, this is totally a distortion. Such an argument is a far cry from facts. You know that for XRL, there was no filibustering and there has not been judicial reviews on XRL. But XRL has the worst overrun of all. And it is the one that has resulted in a lot of anger. So the PIG members thought that they had a good argument, whether they should defend the chief executive. The more they raise such distorted facts, the angrier the public will be. So I'm not asking for the data or the predictions from the contractors. However, I would like to know your data for the next 5 years, so we can know what are the projects envisaged and what are the projects in the estimations. Leung Kok Hong. There are failures for the Lantau investigation. There are failures in the investigations for the XRL, and there are also failures in investigations for the works of the Shatin Central Link. So what are the successful cases? Do you mean that there are judicial reviews leading to the change in the geological composition of the sites? So of all the four overruns, there are all serious overruns. Three are connected with the railway. Vincent Low has a lot of merits in that. Well, he says that he has not enough business now. Well, he has had a lot of money earned in the business. So investigation, is the reason for the claims, because your investigations have not been well done and claims are made against that. So can you do something to improve on such a situation? Permanent Secretary, please respond briefly. Mr. Albert Chen, for the information that he would like to have on the PWP, we can furnish that. As for whether judicial reviews would affect the dates of the commissioning of projects, I don't have the materials at hand, but I will go back and look for them. Now, do you support the funding from the establishment committee? Those who are for seeking the recommendation of the establishment committee, those who are for, raise your hands. Please read out the names of those that are for. Do you want to ring the bell? 5 minutes pause.
就而家我哋就係委員是否
Do you support this item? Establishing a PCMO. Well,
向人事編
Now, do we endorse the funding application for submission to the ESE?Members, please do not shout from your seats. Now, please be seated. Those in favor, please raise your hands. Would the secretary please read out the name, Wu Chi Wai?Mr. Chen Kam Lam, Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, Mr. Yu Si Wing, Mr. Chen Kim Paul, Mr. Chen Han Pan, Mr. Gary Chan, Mr. Leng Chi Cheng, Ms. Els Mac, Dr. Elizabeth Kwok, Ms. Chen Yun Han. Anyone missing? Those against, please raise your hands. We have Dr. KK Kwok,Mr. Elvin Young, Dr. Kenneth Chen, Mr. Ray Chen, Mr. Albert Chen, and Mr. Lan Kuo Hong. Abstentions? No. Thank you. So, thank you very much.We have 12 in favor, 6 against. So the item is passed. Now let's enter the fourth item on the agenda, the demolition of existing structures in sites A and B1 of the Songwon Toy Vehicle Repair and Maintenance Workshop. Now let's invite the administration in.Now, let's welcome the administration. The list is tabled in front of you. I won't introduce them one by one. Now, first of all, let me offer my apologies. The previous item took longer than expected, and as such, you have to wait for a long time. Since time is tight,I understand the administration has prepared a PowerPoint presentation. Now, barring members' objection, I want to allow more time for questions and answers. Now, if members have no comments, the government does not have to walk us through the presentation. So any objections?If not, I will open up the floor for questions. I'd like to remind members that based on Rule 83A of the Rules of Ordinance, if members have any direct or indirect pecuniary interests on the issue, they must disclose the nature of such interests before they speak. Mr. Albert Chen, 4 minutes. Chairman,The management of construction waste has become a hot topic recently. At Lantau Island, Pui O, the habitats of buffaloes at Pui O have been receding, and tons of construction waste are being poured, and Tin Shui Wai is another area affected. The EPD said, these construction waste must be covered, and as such, more and more construction waste are generated. Now, we've been following up on this issue for a very long time. Now, we are looking at a legal issue in terms of managing construction waste, and secondly, we have to deal with the source of these construction waste, and no one seemed to be paying attention. Now, after the demolition of the structures, would the construction waste again go to Puyo, go to different country parks or even residences? Then would they pile up, and at the end, would you have to cover them? So are there any orders or requirements stipulated in such demolition contracts in the current contracts? They are very ambiguous, and there's no stipulation on where the construction waste would go. They simply say as soon the treatment of such waste are illegal, they can continue to dump these waste. And at the end, we have to deal with resort to legal means rather than the contracts. Mr. Lang, thank you very much. In our public works system, we do impose requirements on contractors for this work. We have different sites to receive the waste, including the Northwest New Territories, West New Territories, Tuen Mun, etc. We have minimized the amount of waste to be dumped. Now, it's not about quantity. I mean, are there any requirements or stipulations in the contracts? Now, do these contracts stipulate where the construction waste would end up? Are there any clear instructions? Otherwise, we would face issues in Puyo and Tin Shui Wai again. And we are talking about construction waste from public works. At Puyo, some construction waste are from public works. This is ridiculous. Who will answer this question? Mr. Wong. Thank you very much. As my colleague said, we have two solutions. First of all, we try to reuse the inert construction waste. Only a few percent of non-inert construction waste would be audited. Well, there are no audits. There are no audits at all. As long as the Director of Environmental Protection deems the waste to be unpolluting, they can continue to dump these waste. That's what's happening at Puyo. I wrote to the government, and some members of the public launched judicial reviews. They are suing DPD. I'm not against this work, but you have to explain the waste arrangements very clearly. Where would the construction waste end up? Do you have any specific arrangements, or else I'm going to object to it? Any clear instructions on what to do with the construction waste in the contract? We ask the contractors to submit assessments on the construction waste, and we would assess the report accordingly. Right now, as soon as the construction waste goes somewhere legal, it's acceptable. They are continuing to dump the waste. So we are very angry at the situation. You are counting on other departments to identify whether the waste dumped are legal, and the EPD is not doing its job. According to the ordinance, this is not mandatory. Now, if we don't deal with it, we are going to face repeats of Puyo. Dr. Ken Chen, I have two specific questions. Now, at Site B, B1. Well, you said there would be asbestos. Now, do you have any information on hand? You said you would deal with it. Well, maybe that's what I will write as well if I'm in your shoes. But what does it mean? Asbestos is highly carcinogenic, and there are strict rules. And there are regulations and ordinances on the use of asbestos. Now, in terms of construction waste, now, when you demolish a structure containing asbestos, what are you going to do? You said you would spray, you would sprinkle water or cordon it off. It's not enough. Now, on site B1, now, when we look at the outline zoning plan, S/K/22, well, part of it falls under the CDA zone. Now, from a town planning perspective, you said there would be parks, recreation facilities, and so on. But this area actually falls under the CDA zone. So, how would you deal with this town planning issue? Are there any missing steps which have not been included in this paper? What are you going to do in the future, Mr. Leung? Let me address the second question from Mr. Chen first. On the B1 side, as we said, there are three parts. First, to the left, we have GIC, which would become an outlet, and the other part will be a metro park, and in the middle, based on the existing building heights, it will again be a comprehensive development area, and we have a metro park as well. It will be handed to the relevant departments for open space development.
So you will give the authority back to the departments concerned, because why is it that it will be a comprehensive integrated development area? So there will be the appearance of a privatization of public spaces. So I think that you should have make that clarify that. As for asbestos response, well, taking out asbestos should be given to specialized contractors. Mr. Wong, there are two parts. For the buildings we have now, we have a consultant doing the assessment, and specialists have also had samples taken and analyzed, proving that in the building itself there is asbestos. And so the contractor will be required to do a detailed asbestos report, and through by approval of the Environment Department, and in accordance with the guidelines, they will take they will be very prudent in dealing with that. Member, so when you ask for funding approval, you should have detailed information on the asbestos. So the elimination of asbestos should be done with care. Otherwise, there would be some disastrous results. Mr. Yu Xiyong, in the parts B and C, it is said here that there will be decontamination of the land, and will also remove or divert any existing underground services and tanks. Have you investigated that there are pollutants underground, and what is the extent of the pollution? And if you are to eliminate those pollutants, have you included such decontamination in your consideration of the estimates, because this will affect the health of the people in the vicinity. Response. Thank you for Mr. Yao's views. As for the C, small paragraph, removing any existing underground services and tanks, because there is a tank in the A1 site, but this is a small tank, and there's no contaminants inside. And in B1, there are areas that we will survey and we will decontaminate. In the document in B1, for the B1 site, we will carry out an investigation, and if there is a pollution, we will decontaminate. Now, for the B2 site, in the demolished site, there are pollutants, and we are also undertaking decontamination. Well, so you do not have an overall survey. Response, we have a survey of the, we need to survey the B1. So remember, if you discover lots of pollutants, then you would need to do something about it. Now, we have a soil assessment by a specialist. So as just mentioned, the tank is small. And after decontamination, the soil can be reused there. As for the expenses of decontamination, we have already put out 600,000 for that. Is that enough, member said? Because very often, you discover that the pollutants have been permeated to other places, increasing the budget. So do you think there will be an overrun? Response, the chair. So you mentioned the tank. There's a lot of repair and maintenance by the site. In the process of repair and maintenance of the vehicles, very often there could be chemicals and there could be petrol permeated into the ground. Now, so for your preliminary investigation, has it been thorough? Would it be that investigation has not been sufficient? If you say that you will have a garden, parks, and even residential areas in this site, these are all concerns. If you do not have a thorough investigation and thorough decontamination, who would be responsible for the aftermath? So you cannot mention just the tank, because there are years of vehicle repair and maintenance since 1963 that had been done in this site. So what are the areas where the land is contaminated? And this is a concern for the members present. Response, Mr. Cheung. For sites A and B, we have basically completed decontamination. So in fact, these few years, we have been undertaking decontamination. In fact, we have completed most of it. There is only one borehole. There is structure. So there is this hole that we have not decontaminated, whereas all the areas have been decontaminated. So we have bored 28 holes, and there are 10 holes that we discovered contaminants. And we enlarged contaminated holes. So we dug deep into it, a deep well, and we all excavated the soil, 3 meters deep soil. So the chair said, oh, right, so you have done a lot of work. Apart from one area where there are the structure above that you have not done yet. Lo Wai Kwok. Members have raised questions on the contamination in the demolishing of existing structures. Now, for the decontamination arrangement, is it a normalized act that has to be done? Even if it cannot be done immediately, that will it will be done as soon as possible. What is it a normal undertaking? Because in the West District, there are, for instance, at the incineration plant, it has been demolished a long time ago. Can it be done? What was decontamination was not done right away, and now we are talking about the decontamination of that area. Response: if we feel that the structure or the building could result in soil contamination, we immediately ask for the contamination assessment. And the details of the report and also the decontamination should be approved by the Environment Department to ensure that we do it. We deal with it in a proper time. Remember the example I raised, because in the past it had been not immediate dealt with. So now, once the assessment done, the decontamination should be done right away. Mr. Albert Chen, I'll come back to the question I raised. The question was not answered. According to the PWP in general, you are now equivalent to, the way you approach it is equivalent to allowing the contractors to dump the construction waste anywhere. So would you, in the contract itself, precisely state that it cannot be done? So now in the contract, it is not specified where the construction waste would go. So the contractor would say in the contract itself where they would dump their wastes. So when you oversee the implementation of the contract, you can say exactly, say you want to, you specify it in the contract, you dump it in a certain area and you would not allow it to be dumped in Buyo or in Sha Tin or in anywhere else. So when you come to the works subcommittee, you already specify in the contract itself the precise area where the construction waste will be taken to. Would you do that? Response. Thank you. Question from Mr. Albert Ho Chen. Of course, in the contract itself, we specify the completion date. So that's the first point. Secondly, we now have a supervision of the contractor. Albert Chen, you are not answering my question, because dumping it in Buyo is not in contrary to your present contract. Mr. Albert Chen has some justification in his view. Of course, you can specify where it can be dumped, but you can also approved, go to the approved area. Well, in the tender itself, you should specify that, Mr. Albert Chen. Well, there could be several areas, for instance, areas A, B, C, D, that they can dump the wastes. So when you accept the contract, you accept also these sites. Because if it goes to the Buyeo agricultural land, of course, you won't accept it. But the problem now we have is that these sites that they are dumped, their wastes are not sites that are not considered to be illegal at present. Well, in the tender itself, it's not you, the government, who will specify the sites for dumping the wastes. They would propose sites, and if you approve the contract, you also approve the sites. Response: in the tender itself, or in the approval of the site of the tender, will know exactly where the dumps will go, the waste will go, and of course the government will consider whether that can be accepted. So, if you, Mr. Chen believes that such a supervision, if you don't have a site being mentioned, you cannot very well supervise the dumping of the sites into the sites. This is a matter of concern for Mr. Chen. Any other questions? If not, the discussion of this item will end here. Are you in support of the funding application to the Public Works Committee?
Now, at the PWSC, the government should hopefully address Mr. Albert Chen's concern. Thank you. Now, let's move on to the fifth item on the agenda. Improvement of water supply to Shangsha and Fanling. Let's invite the administration in. The list of attendees are tabled, so I won't introduce them one by one. My apologies, since we spent longer than expected for the previous item, so we have a little overrun. The administration has prepared a PowerPoint presentation, but since time is limited, barring objections from members, we can skip the presentation. Can the administration introduce the project briefly before we open up the floor for questions? So please be brief. Thank you. We want to introduce the improvement of water supply to Shangsha and Fanling. In the next few years, we have new developments at the Queen's Hill. We have new public housing developments which require fresh water and salt water. And at Table Hill, we propose constructing a 24,000 cubic meter service reservoir as well as two trunk mains. Hopefully, members can endorse our funding application at PWSC. Now, the floor is open for questions. And according to Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedure, if members have any direct or indirect pecuniary interests on the issue, they must disclose the interests, the nature of such interests, before they speak. Now, we have two members in the line, Mr. Yu Siwing and Mr. Edward Chen. Dr. Kenneth Chen. Mr. Yu Siwing, 4 minutes, please. Thank you. Now, under this project, two trunk mains will be laid, and it's extremely long. And according to the information paper, no resumption of private land is required. I'm not sure if the laying of trunk mains would affect the nearby residents and villages. Now, if they would be affected, how much time is required? And what are the procedures for laying the mains? How can we minimize disturbance to the residents during the construction? Who can answer this question? Mr. Lang. The laying of mains would take place at Jockey Club Road and Mankam Toe. The impact to villages is minimal. We have conducted a transport impact assessment, and we found that our current building method has minimal impact on traffic. I looked at the layout and I see that the mains pass by two villages. Is that right, Mr. Lang? They pass by roads only. The part in red, the red dotted line represents the mains, right? Are you referring to enclosure one? Yes. The proposed area of work, you can see the two villages. Are you referring to Hongqiu Sanxun? The mains would not pass by the village. It would be laid at Mankam Toe. Have you conducted site checks? Yes, we have. Otherwise, if you affect the villages, you would affect their lives, and project progress would be affected as well. We have conducted site checks, including Mankam Toe. The mains would not pass by the villages. Mr. Albert Chen, I have two questions. One, as I said, the construction waste, I hope the government can follow suit, so I won't repeat myself. And second, for the water supply scheme, the water supply, water is only supplied to part of the area in New Territories, northwest. Would there be other water supply schemes? Why don't you come up with a bigger scheme and reserve extra or spare capacity to meet future needs? First, the management of construction waste. On in the works contracts, we would stipulate where the construction waste must go, and we would adopt a trip ticket system to make sure that the waste would end up where they should be. And at the sites, can we expand the scope of the facilities to meet future needs? At the Table Hill site, we have already exploited all the space we can use, and we would construct a 24,000 cubic meter reservoir. For future developments, we have to identify another site for a new service reservoir. So simply speaking, you're just going to enhance what you have right now. this system takes care of the water supply needs at the public housing developments at Queens Hill. Any follow-up from Mr. Chen? I'm not very familiar with that area. Well, as you know, Fanling is very big, and there are a lot of developments at Northwest New Territories, and there is some strong demand for water. So if you are able to plan ahead, then the unit costs would drop. I'm not very familiar with that area, so I cannot give very concrete comments on whether this use of space has been maximized. If you can plan ahead, it will be more cost-effective. Have you catered for future development needs, apart from Queens Hill? Have you maximized the use of space? What does it mean? The Table Hill site is actually not very big. Now, we have already built the biggest reservoir we can. Now, the water supply can only meet the needs of Queens Hill. It cannot meet the needs of Northwest New Territories. So you have considered this factor, right? Dr. Kan Chen, thank you. The Queens Hill development has faced various hiccups. The initial plan was to build a private university, but after CY Leung assumed office, he wants to build public housing. And there have been constant changes and adjustments. Now, for this new service reservoir and associated facilities, have you catered for potential capacity or demand at the future Queens Hill public housing development? If you have figures, please share them with us as soon as possible. You cannot lay the mains before you conduct the planning. So hopefully you won't have to come back for retrospective works. And in the sixth paragraph of the paper, you said Shengshou and Fanling are presently using fresh water for flushing. As you know, we don't want to waste fresh water because water is precious. Now, if we extend the facilities to Queens Hill, we would still be using fresh water. So why can't we be more forward-looking? We should start to make a transition. We can start from Queens Hill and extend it to other areas in Fanling and Shengshou. We should use stormwater or even recycled water. Now, you might no longer use fresh water for flushing. Can you give us a response? For Queens Hill, we might not need to use fresh water, or we can even use recycled fresh water for flushing, which would be an even greener approach. Would that be feasible? Are you going to provide this option? Thank you. Now I'll try to address both questions. Now, to meet population growth, including the four service reservoirs in Shengshui and Fanling, this new reservoir can serve around 370,000 people. We mainly serve residents of Queens Hill, and we are talking about 12,000 units. And on the use of recycled water for Shengshou and Fanling, we are performing planning at the moment, and we are looking at the relevant laws to see if any amendments are needed. technically we know that it's feasible. So as we said in the paper, when designing for the new system, we have allowed for certain flexibility. If we are to implement the use of recycled water in the future, this service reservoir would become a supply reservoir for recycled water. So some work has to be done in terms of connections to the buildings. Right now, each building has two systems, one for fresh water, one for flush water. So in the new system, we will only connect it to the flush water system. At the moment, fresh water is used for flushing, but when we implement the use of recycled water, it would be used for flush water. So we have some flexibility. Why don't they make a decision already? Since they are considering it already, I think you should treasure our precious water resources and make a decision. You shouldn't come back for more money. Right now, it's technically feasible, but they have to deal with the legislation. Is that correct, Mr.
Mac?
The waterworks ordinance do not specify this area, so we are looking at, we are studying the possibility. So in terms of design, there is flexibility, and if changes are to be made, there would be costs. Currently, recycled water is not allowed. That's the government's approach. They are doing it bit by bit, piece by piece. Now, I just want to state my stance. The Queen's Hill was originally penciled for a private university, and now it's for public housing. We are talking of a population of 40,000 to 50,000. That would be more cost effective. So I hope the legislative amendments can be made as soon as possible. We hope that you won't come back for more funds when you make the switch from fresh water to recycled water. I think there's some flexibility in terms of the system design. And if it can be done, then we can save some money.
I also understand what problems the government is facing. Mr. Chen wish to have an acceleration of this approach, the use of recycled water. Mr. Chen Ka-kung, I am the chairman and vice chairman of the Environment Committee with Mr. Kenneth Chen. Freshwater flushing has been used in the Northern Territories, and a lot of fresh water is being wasted. If for the Queen's Hill, we can have a mega pilot project using seawater for flushing or recycled water for flushing, that would be ideal. Of course, here in the document itself, it will have twin mains that could be used for recycled water flushing or seawater flushing. I would like to know if you can have seawater linked up from shuttlecock with a pipe. Now, changing this water supply for flushing, how much money would it cost to convert? As for recycled water, in the last few years, there had been a pilot project in the North Territory, and that was successful for school toilets. Now, the results have not been presented in the LegCo. The schools were happy with that, according to what we heard. And when the pilot project was on, there was no mentioning of the modification of laws. Now, this is the first time that I hear that there has to be a change in the laws. Now, in the policy address, it is also said that there should be seawater flushing for the North Territories. What is the schedule envisaged? Response. Thank you for the question. As for the seawater flushing, in the northern part of New Territories, they are not really near to the sea. We had a study before. Seawater flushing for that area is not cost effective. On the contrary, using recycled water for flushing is more cost effective. And Mr. Chen also mentioned that in the last few years, we had a pilot project in Fenling, producing recycled water for schools. And the people are quite happy with it. So from the pilot project, we proved that it is technically feasible. If we use seawater, the salty water, for flushing, well, seawater cannot be used in a different variety of areas, whereas you can use recycled water. The third grade of recycled water can be used in different areas. In fact, such recycled water is not much different from potable water. So would that the third grade recycled water be used in that way? Well, that is a matter that we have to study and to see whether the law would allow that. We are not we are doing it at the same time, looking into the juridical aspect of it and looking also into the technical aspect of it. In terms of design, we will leave a lot of flexibility so that for instance, we have twin mains now that we can use the recycled water. For the reservoir also, we have two full compartments. So in the design itself, we can still go into another recycled water without much conversion. So our discussion will end here. Will members support the Public Works Subcommittee for the proposed upgrading of the category? Thank you. Upgrading. Thank you. Item 6, updated the development of Anderson Road Quarry Site. Please invite the representatives of the government into the meeting room. I would like to welcome the representatives from the government. You have the list, and I would not introduce them here. Since we have spent quite a lot of time for the other items of the agenda, this item, the discussion will last until a quarter past 12. I will prolong the meeting at the most 15 minutes. I hope you can accept this extension. The government has a PowerPoint for presentation. I think that this is quite unnecessary for the sake of time. I think basically we all know, we have read the documents presented to us. Perhaps you can briefly introduce the item without going to the PowerPoint. Thank you. briefly speaking, the background of the item. We hope that you support us, the development of the Anderson Quarry site, as well the site formation and associated infrastructure works. This is a measure to increase land supply. It will increase 9,000 private and public housing units and could and this will go from 2023 to 2024. It will provide land for institutions, governments, and amenity facilities, etc. We have revised the Kuntong North District ZP, and this revised OZP was approved. And the design of the site and the investigation have also received funding from the LegCo. And in the February this year, we have completed the design, and we hope that this this part of the project will be raised to category A, and we also would all also like to have pedestrian connectivity off-site. And if this received funding from the Finance Committee, we will start work in November this year. And this will be completed by the year 2022. And in the beginning of 2017, the remaining works, apart from the off-site roads and also some improvement, the pedestrian connectivity facilities, as well as amenity works, we will have another application for funding by the beginning of 2017. We're ready to answer your questions. Chairman, I would like to remind you that according to Article 83A, Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedure, if members have direct or indirect pecuniary interest, members should disclose the nature of the interest before speaking. Two members, Mr. Albert Chen and Mr. Chen Hakin, and Mr. Leung Hak, would like to raise questions. Albert Chen, this project has been discussed over many years. I would like to know, in the OEZP, has it already been done? Has it been settled? Secondly, the proportion of private housing and PHP. So the Anderson Quarry site is very big. Is it 80% for public housing and 20% for private housing? Would that be parts where the proportion of HOS will be higher? As with respect to the OZP, it has already been completed. It has also been approved and gazetted in January. As for the proportion of the private sector and the public sector housing, there has been a lot of discussion. As for the development of the Anderson Road Quarry site, the public sector housing will be 20% and the private will be 80%. I think that for the Kuntong area and the Selmoping area and for the Anderson Road Quarry site, the public housing is proportion is very high. Now the proportion is over 70%. 70% will be public housing. So at the time we were discussing about the Anderson project, there will be a more balanced proportion. For the whole area, the private-public proportion will be 70% and 30%. I could not really agree with that because for the district councils, when the public housing were demolished for afterwards, people would be against building again a public housing area, housing in the same site. But since the rich and powerful in the council, they are against it. Well, you should have at least 60%, 40% rate, and not to speak of 80 and 20% rate. The government says that there are no land for the public housing. Why should it be 80% and 20%? And I think this is criminal. This is unfair for the grassroots. We are indeed very angry. Mr. Chen, of course, he's not he cannot decide that. But Mr. Zheng Binglong should be shot. Well, this is a policy, since the government is policy-led, well, then you should also fight for the public housing. The district council is discriminating against the grassroots. Does it mean that you don't build public housing just because of that? I also mentioned that in the Songmenping area, I'm not talking about areas. Chairman, Albert Chen, it is absurd. Well, you are building new housing. You should satisfy needs. You should see what the urgent needs of the people are. You said that you have no land for public housing, but however, there are acres of land here, 80% to 20%. Well, you can have a rate of 60%, 20%. Chairman, well, your time is up. You can have a second round.
I hope the administration can address what Mr. Chen said. Now, I'd like to supplement some facts. In Kuntong, the ratio is 70 to 30%. For Xiao Mao Ping, the ratio of subsidized housing has reached 90%. So 90% in public housing and 10% in private. For some districts, the ratio is 100%. Now, this logic is ridiculous. We are talking about this project. Now, I think we should clarify the figures. A lot of people would want to know. At the Anderson Road development, and from 2015 to 70, the majority are public housing developments. The ratio would rise to 93% in public housing. So, it would be an ideal private to subsidized housing ratio. In Taikoo, 100% private development. So the logic is unreasonable. Next, Mr. Gary Chen. Mr. Gary Chen. We've been discussing this project for a long, long time. And I think the public and members are very concerned about traffic. As of now, we have not heard anything satisfactory. This site will house about 25,000 people at Xiao Mao Ping and the adjacent areas. The traffic load is already very heavy. Over the course of construction, we have a lot of heavy vehicles going in and out of the site. Would that create a big burden on the regional traffic? And when these 25,000 people move in eventually, I think with a higher private to subsidized housing ratio, the number of vehicles would also rise. At the Potat Village roundabout or the road from Chang Kwan O to Potat village, it's already very just congested during the rush hours. Now, let's not get into Kuntong. A lot of people have voiced concerns on this front. So, as of now, has the government responded to the district councillors' concerns on traffic or congestion? We can see that a lot of public housing residents might take their kids to school by walking, and we see a pedestrian linkage system. The use of such linkage systems have led to congestion of people. In the morning and afternoon hours, a lot of school children would be stuck, and the line is extremely long, so this does not seem to be a viable answer. So we face a burden in traffic. When we have 25,000 moving in, we would have heavy congestion. Mr. Chang, thank you. Thank you very much for the question. He's worried about traffic congestion during construction. We have actually come up with estimates. We have estimated the number of vehicles in the construction phase. We understand the potential impacts, and as such, we stipulated in the works contracts that contractors cannot allow the heavy vehicles to enter the site during the rush hours. And as for the issue of traffic, we have conducted a detailed traffic impact assessment for the Anderson Road site, quarry site, to the east. A link would lead into the Cheung Kwan Oh Tunnel. 70% of the traffic would be eastbound. The remaining 30% would reach Choi Hong via Repulse Bay Road. On the long run, we would rely on the commissioning of the Lam Tin Cheung Kwan Oh Tunnel. With the commissioning of that tunnel, part of Cheung Kwan Oh Road would be vacated. Now, Mr. Chen is worried about a congestion of people at the linkage pedestrian linkage systems at Hua Xin. We have a few elevators, and we have ample carrying capacity for Hua Xin. We have escalators as well. So when there are a lot of people, they can use escalators. Have you done anything more scientific? What's the average waiting time during the rush hours for each lift? For each elevator, we see that the capacity is adequate. How long do they have to wait? This depends on the height of the lift. I think Mr. Chen is only worried about long queues. And you said people can walk if the queues are long. Every time the elevator comes up, then I think everyone can just go into the lift and reach the ground floor. So do you mean that the waiting times are very short? So perhaps the waiting time might be 1 minute. Well, I can only say that the waiting time is reasonable. Next, Mr. Lam Kwa-hung, on the housing ratio, I find this interesting. Do you plan to build some public housing at the mid-levels, or the mid-levels have no public housing at all? there would not be congestion due to public housing because the population density is very low. Are you going to consider that based on your logic? You said the areas adjacent to Anderson Road are full of public housing developments. If this is your policy, for areas with a lot of private housing, should you build more? Should you build some private public housing? Do you have such policy? Now, I just want to point this out to you. For four major estates, I've repeated them: Valley Estate, North Point Estate, Wong Chuk Hang Estate. These are the three major housing estates. They have been demolished and they've been converted into private housing. Part of Homantin Village has been turned private as well. For the Union Hospital, it spans 2 hectares. One is for private development. So what kind of policy is this? Now for Northeast New Territories, you're saying that we don't have enough housing, and as such, we want to build some housing in Northeast New Territories for the quarry site. The ratio is 80 to 20, so how can you explain yourself to the people of Hong Kong? A very simple question. You are trying to grab as much land as possible. At the Hong Kong Baptist University, there's a site for a hospital. You said you need low-density developments, private developments at Kowloon Tong. So do we have any... How much public housing do we have at Kowloon Tong? Now, this logic is plain wrong. Why don't you build more public housing in Kowloon Tong? If you care so much about the private-to-subsidized housing ratio, why don't you do something to correct it? Why are there so many private contracts in Kowloon Tong? I cannot even visit every one of them. Some sites are used for tennis courts. What kind of policy is this? So why don't you resume all the land? If you want to play golf, you can go to Shenzhen. You know, it's very convenient. Now that you have a lot of roads, you can play golf there. Why isn't this what you do? Now, you can tell us that we don't know what's happening. You said you might say there's too much public housing already, but what about the additional traffic? We have a lot of drivers. The official here said, now if you have 2,200 people divided by 60 minutes, how long do we have to wait? Now, this is only an average figure. Of course, there must be congestion. Is there a policy in place to carry out land resumption at areas with little public housing in order to balance the ratio of subsidized and private housing? What about at the peak? Is there any public housing? Your time's up, Leung Kwok Hong. Now let's allow the administration to respond on the use of land. Thank you. Thank you very much for the question. Now let me offer a brief answer. On the use of housing, and we follow the housing targets of the Long-Term Housing Committee. 60% would be public housing and 40% private developments. When we develop new development areas, we would follow this ratio of 60 to 40% under the long-term housing objectives for specific land lots, we have to consider the surrounding environment and make adjustments accordingly. For other sites, for example, Kennedy Town, substantial public housing has been included in order to meet district needs. So my question was, are they planning to resume public land in Kowloon and the Peak and build public housing? He talked about a balance. Do you have such plans? You said you would look at specific areas. Now, can I help him? Your time's up, Mr. Lam Kwok Hong. If you you have to wait for the next round. Anything in response on the use of land and public and the government policy? When we allocate new land resources, we would follow the 60-40% ratio, and this is what we will do. I have some questions as well. We are talking about almost $7.7 billion. Mr. Chen said these works would be carried out in phases. So is it possible to break these projects down into smaller pieces? Some members are worried about competition. We talked about project cost management. Now we are talking about very big sums. So what measures would you adopt? In recently, a lot of mega projects have seen major cost overruns, and we talked about establishing a project cost management office. But we are unsure when the office will actually be set up. So in terms of cost control, what kind of improvement measures are available?
Well, so if you have cost management, we won't have such a lot of debate on funding. Thank you. This for the 7.7 billion funding, it includes formation of the site as well as the corridors and also the improvements of the roads. So we will break them up into smaller contracts, and we will have several contracts, and that will also reflect the market requirements as well as the specific cities of the different works. We also have a particular staff in charge of management costs, and for several works we will also adopt NECs as a model for our contracts. Past experience proved that the NECs have a good impact on cost management. Chairman, a follow-up of the question raised of, for the population needs. So what do you mean by in a reasonable time? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For instance, for the three lifts, we have a testing of the requirements. So at peak hours, in the Hua line, the passenger need is 1,800 per hour, 1,850 per hour. So there will be 1,580 inhabitants for the three lifts, And the capacity of the three lifts is 2,210. So the capacity is quite enough to meet the population need. Now, 3 minutes for Mr. Le Guohong. So divide this 2,010 by 60 minutes. It's 200 is about 40 per minute. So you have two bottlenecks because you cannot estimate the two ways up and down. So it's, I think you do not. I do not think that you can estimate it by lifts, but you can do it by escalators because the escalators can reverse the direction. Escalators do not have to have do not have such a long wait. Well, I lived in a public housing, and I'm still living in a public housing, so I know what it is about. Now, for the 80-20 ratio, I am not convinced. When the CY Leung regime said that, you know, they wanted to have public housing, but they couldn't find land. Well, this is a political disaster. Well, land. Well, we have to protect the real estate market. Well, if you have a 60-40 ratio, we will give you we'll give you support when you have a better ratio. Well, I oppose the policies that are in favor of the real estate tycoons. But now, you said that you have a lot of pressure. I supported him for this tax, the surtaxes for the purchase of flats. I did support him. Are you CY Leung and Chen Kingpong? Are you? Do you have the courage to change this land ratio? That the land ratio will be in favor of the low income group, those who earn under 1,400. If you do have such a policy, I would support you. On the contrary, I am opposed to such a ratio that as you present here. You have to change this ratio. If you do not change this ratio, there will be troubles. 80-20 ratio? Do you take us for a fool? This is so. What is the ratio? The chairman said. As for the quarry site, the schedule here is 80% for private sector and 20% for the subsidized housing. However, we have to look into the general situation of the whole area. If you look at the Sun Tin Sun Lei estate, these are the areas for public housing. So when we are carrying out consultations, Chair, Mr. Leung Kung Ho, you should allow the government representative to answer. Well, go to the peak and go to the Kowloon Tong for public housing. If you build 30% of public housing in the peak and in the Kowloon Tong, I will support you. You know, we are angry about such a way of dealing with things. The policy should be done in accordance with the situation, the facts on the ground. The chair. Mr. Liu, you should give the representative time to respond. Well, you should focus on this item. The government representative, Thomas Chen. Well, we will take as a principle the 60-40 ratio. However, we should also take into account the environment where the site is, so we can have reach an appropriate ratio. For this site, we feel that the 80-20 ratio and is appropriate. Since we have had consultations and we have received support from the council, well, you can ask CY Leung to be the chairman of all the 18 councils. Or does he want to be the chamber of real estate business? 60-40% cannot solve the problem. The right ratio is 50-50 or even more. So now you want to have 80-20. It's outrageous. Now, do you support that this? Do you endorse putting this upgrading of the to category A, and seek the approval of the PW subcommittee? Oh, well, I did not claim a division. Well, I am opposed to it. I did not require a ring of the bell for the claim of division. Well, let us ring the bell for 5 minutes. I extended the meeting for 15 minutes, so our meeting goes on to 12:30. However, if after the ringing of the bell, it will be beyond 12:30. Do you oppose the another extension? If you oppose another extension of the time, then we'll have to vote next time. At the next meeting, we will vote on this item because time is short now. You are going against the rules. Members, the time for our meeting, including the 15 minutes extension, the meeting should end at 12:30. And since there was a claim for division, we had to ring the division bell for 5 minutes. And after the ring of the bell, we have gone beyond 12:30. So the voting has to wait until next meeting. So now we need to end the meeting. No other business. So the meeting is adjourned. Thank you.